Hi, my name is Kori Carter. Thank you for showing up to our senior project night. We all truly do appreciate it. My project is about the lack of representation of Black people involved in real estate, both as investors and owners, but also as corporate leaders and business owners of real estate. Now, we know that real estate is a large part of economic ecosystem that builds the economy in such a way that is vital to everyone. Real estate is involved in everything. If you're on this earth, real estate is involved. Whether it's just land, or it's just a building, or it's your home, or whatever it may be, real estate is involved. Black people have really suffered on the other end of not being able to acquire the same amount of wealth as other demographics. We have been kept from obtaining the same type of housing, the same type of loans, the same type of representation, and the same type of opportunities as other communities. And because of that, we haven't been able to build as much wealth, quickly sell our assets that have been brought up in the family because of the lack of education and the importance of keeping that within the family. And so we find ourselves in this loophole of needing help and needing housing, but not necessarily knowing how to be a part of that movement. And so you'll see me being able to talk to leading Black professionals that have taken it upon themselves to be a part of something bigger and invest into real estate and go through certain hurdles to be the face of a person of color investing and building their community, specifically in the Pacific Northwest and more specifically in the Central District. You'll see imagery of segregation, gentrification, redlining, and all of that that has really taken a toll on the Central District. And now you're seeing it evolved into something that is not what it used to be, which is an historically mesh pot of people that were essentially banned from other communities within Seattle. So not only will you get to see the historic presence of that, but you'll also get to see me interviewing people in the current day that are taking steps to build network, build connection, invest, build wealth for their own families, and talk about the importance of representation in community building and educating, you know, people outside of our community, the value in having diverse perspectives, the value of educating Black people on investing and wealth building through real estate. So I hope that you truly enjoy this presentation and walk you guys through the process as this story unfolds. Thank you. Obviously, segregation and redlining took a financial and educational toll on the Black community. So I wanted to see how current Black developing leaders went about disrupting the history of systematic oppression. Here is Jebediah Gardner, a young Black developer in Seattle area, telling you his story.
I went to UW. I went to University of Washington. I was an English major. Worked for Turner Construction as a project engineer. Then I started my company after I got laid off from Turner, 2009. And then I went to law school, applied to law school, and got laid off at the same time and started my business all at the same time. And basically, when my experience at Turner Construction building commercial high-rises downtown Seattle gave me tons of knowledge and experience on what it really takes to build a $100 million plus building. I got that education right out of college when I was like maybe 23 or so. And that was kind of my first taste in the professional world. Obviously, I was the only person of color in the office working on that project. So I got beat up a lot. There's a lot of microaggression and bias and racism that would happen, but I was really not aloof. I just was, you know, like not trained to not make a big deal about it in the corporate world because, like, you can lose your job.
What he said sounded familiar. And as you can see, there's a trend of what it means to be Black in the commercial real estate industry. Here are the many Black leading professionals in commercial real estate talking about their experiences.
So I had to eat a lot of that crow, but at the same time, I just learned the game. And then after I learned the game, I was like, yo, like, being a contractor is cool, building is cool, but who are developers? How do they have $150 million? What are their names? You know, like, so I started inquiring about who our clients were, and they were more like people, my bosses at Turner were more like, just do the work, just do the work. We'll go to the client meetings, you just sit there. And so I just did my own homework, and I was like, looks like being a real estate developer is where a lot of wealth is created and generated.
Jabida posed a great question. Who were the developers?
I saw that a lot of the CEOs and developers and project managers within the company didn't look anything like us. I went to three different companies' websites, and this is what I found. No one that looked remotely like me. So I found this interview from Mark Winton. He talks about the importance of investing in education amongst the Black community so we can keep the assets that were acquired in our families from generations and to be able to use that knowledge to build wealth for our own families in the future. Let's take a listen.
That's my main job and my main mission and why I'm here this morning. So I want you to look at it like this, all right? As a real estate investor, and first of all, you know, it's very important for people, especially in our community, to get involved in real estate because real estate has made the most millionaires in our country, right? And most people who are wealthy do invest in real estate or have some form of hard asset, whether it be commercial, residential, you're doing Section 8 rental properties, whatever the case may be. People outside our community come mm-hmm. in and buy stuff from us that, you know, our parents and grandparents worked so hard to acquire. And then, you know, because the majority, I would say, of us don't really have the knowledge to get out here and do it, we losing our assets. We losing our generational wealth. And it shouldn't be like that,
right?
You know?
Yeah, because the first thing people are going to say is, I don't have the money to buy land. That's why it's good that you're saying, no, I have the information.
Yes, it's the information, absolutely. Yeah, I'm telling you, man, like, we got to get involved. Like, mm-hmm. I'm telling you, we got to get involved. I keep running, jumping the aqueducts, fire hydrants and hazard. The smoke alarms on the back of us, but mama, don't cry for me, ride for me, try for me, live for me, breathe for me, sing for me, honestly, guiding me. I can be more than I got to be, stole from me, lie to me, nation, hypocrisy, gold on me, driving me wicked.
I don't come from money, I don't come from wealth. And so when you are in the real estate development game, it's just kind of a given that you have to build relationships with people who've been doing business with other people for 30, 40 plus years. Mm-hmm. And here comes this young 20, 30 year old Black real estate developer trying to get in the same room, trying mm-hmm. to sit at the same table. Mm-hmm. There are overarching challenges that are just specifically related to real estate that every developer just kind of goes up against. And then you layer that on with me being young, and then you layer that on with being a POC. And then it adds for all kinds of fun.
This is my mentor, Felicia Collier. She is an associate director at CBRE, and she also does property management for new development of their buildings.
So now we finally have a seat at the table. At this diversity panel event, we get to see firsthand leading Black industry professionals integrating and talking about their experiences and perspectives on how to have a more inclusive work environment and how to continue to promote inclusivity within the company. Let's watch.
Here in Seattle, we just started our AIM chapter. We did not have a African-American networking group here in Seattle, and I've asked Carolyn to establish a AIM network here in the Portland and Seattle area. What is working is that CBRE support in advertising and marketing the initiatives across the board. And as previously mentioned, you don't have to just be African American to be a part of AIM. We welcome everyone. It's about a movement. It's about helping people feel comfortable within the culture of CBRE, helping people grow and helping them excel. So then I come to Seattle, and then there's not other people that I see that look like me. And then trying to make sure that I establish an environment that's welcoming to not necessarily people that look like me, but so that people that don't look like me can also create an environment. It's easy to work with people that look like you, that think like you, but then how more interesting is it to create that diversity, to give that additional perspective or a different thought process than what you're used to? And so even as a manager, I try to instill in my staff to be open-minded, to be fair. And I think that being with CBRE and having different affinity groups, it affords me the opportunity to come to my own perspective, and I will share this with you, that even though I'm African American, I don't believe in equality. I believe in fairness, right? So we all might not get the same slice of pie, we might not all get the same opportunity, but I think as long as you're afforded the opportunity, then that's fair. And I just want to create an environment that's fair and gives people that opportunity. I think CBRE is that I have seen that. If it wasn't for AANG, I wouldn't still be here at CBRE, honestly. It came to a point where I would look at org charts for different branches of GWS, look at org charts for asset services, and there wouldn't be anybody that looked like me. And I would be saying to myself, what am I doing here and why? It just doesn't seem attainable. It just doesn't seem realistic that I would put in the work and be given the opportunity to be at a director level and above. Because when you look at it from paper, it just doesn't make sense. And then one day when I was just like, I'm just gonna figure out something else or go to a different company, an announcement came that Tanya Brandon had been selected as a VP. And I was like, oh, people in those positions that look like you give you a sense of hope. To see people in those positions that look like you give you an idea that it's attainable and it's not unrealistic. And so I know that I've talked to others who say the same thing about seeing me in my position. And although it's not a C-suite position, they still feel like it's attainable. It's something that I can do just to know that you're there.
So I hope you guys enjoyed that documentary. I hope you guys enjoyed the imagery. I hope you guys enjoyed the interviews. To wrap it all up and to sum it all up, representation matters, especially in corporate real estate, especially with wealth building, especially with building your own real estate investments. And personally, having my own business in development and acquiring assets is very important to me because it's very important to me that I give back to my community that's passionate for me. And I hope by this documentary, it exposes not only the truth behind why there's such a large gap, but also the experiences that we go through even when we do finally get to that place. But it's through perseverance and hard work and through education where we find peace with continuing to persevere, because not only is it a great money maker, it's a great way to build community as well. So thank you for watching. Have a good night. Reflection don't mean a thing. This is solo life.